As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaykum as-salamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira thumma amma ba'd. I'm really overwhelmed, mashallah, with the presence of all these beautiful faces, brothers and sisters, and with a very warm welcoming of this community. This is my first time in this area, my first time in the masjid in this area. As a matter of fact, I didn't even know that there was a masjid in this area until just last weekend. So I'm really, mashallah, impressed by the great achievement of the Muslim community in this area. So, jazakumullah khair wa barakallahu fiikum.
Amen.
Family affairs is the topic of our evening, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. And I'm a very, very strong believer. Like, I know there are so many other people who believe in the same way. I'm a very strong believer that love in the family life can fix very, very broken relationships between children and parents, between husband and wife. The question is, how do you define it? And how do you refine it once you find it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rum, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. And among his signs is this, that he has created for you. He has created for you, not for anybody else, but you. خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ, from amongst yourselves. أَزْوَاجًا, that means couple, means spouses. أَزْوَاجًا, for what? What's the purpose of that? لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا, so that you might find peace and tranquility with them. You're supposed to find peace and tranquility when you get married, right? They're laughing already. Says, my God, is that really the purpose of getting married? So why am I having all these difficulties right now? Well, again, it depends on how you define it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا, so that you might find peace and tranquility with them. So the husband, we assume the husband would find peace and tranquility with his wife. The wife should find peace and tranquility with her husband. And then, alhamdulillah, we live happily ever after. But that's not the reality of life. قال الله تعالى, afterwards, continuing the ayah, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَهُمْ بَيْنَكُمَا مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And he placed between you, now between two brackets, between your hearts, مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. The word مَوَدَّةً is one of the shades of love. In the Arabic language, the word love is حُبْد. So حُبْد, two letters, حَا and بَا, just two letters. So easy and so simple to pronounce, so difficult to achieve. So he said, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمَا مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. One thing unique about the Arabic language is that when it comes to words, there are different words that represent spectrum of two extremes, on the right side and the left side, and then you have love shades in between. So each one of them, each shade or each part of that spectrum actually gives a shade of the meaning of that whole word. So the common word for love in the Arabic language is حُبْ. However, the hub can come in the relationship in many, many different forms. Remember those people when they were, you remember yourself when you were young? How you interpreted love? And then when you got married, how it became different? And when you have the first child, it became different. When you have the first fight, how it became different? And so on. It all translates itself and transforms itself in different, subhanAllah, different shades. One of these shades, the Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Mawadda. And the shade of love here in Mawadda, it has the sense and the meaning of kindness, gentleness. That's the meaning of love with the word Mawadda. If you want to talk about lustful love, they call it ishq, animal. So the ishq, if you want to talk about being crazy with love, that's huyam, tatayyum, and have other actual shades of it as well. And when you have something that makes you sick, sacrifice of love, it has also other shades. But the one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for this ayah says mawadda. Love is associated with kindness and tenderness. And then the other quality Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says warahma, and mercy. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمَا مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. He placed between your hearts mawadda, there is love in that sense, in that shade of love, warahma, and mercy. You guys know what mercy is. When someone says Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, he is the most merciful, the most compassionate. So it's the word love and mercy. Mercy, for your knowledge, is one of the shades of love. It's one of the shades of love. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-Rahman, ar-Rahim. Out of love for what He creates subhanahu wa ta'ala, He shows them this compassion. That's why He's the most compassionate. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, because of that, we understand that Allah created all of this out of love, subhanahu wa ta'ala, this creation. Now we also have this amongst ourselves, mawaddata wa rahma. So we have love and mercy between the husband and wife. A question. So why were they associated together? Because that's what the reality of life. Relationships usually run on one of these two qualities, love and mercy. The best and perfect relationship is the one that runs on both. But most relationships, unfortunately, you know, when under stress, they start running out of one and increasing the other one. Take the example of the young couple when they first get married. What would they be running on, ya jama'ah? Is it love or mercy? Mostly it's love. The young couple, they only see themselves through the eyes and the glasses of love. But then as they get older in relationship, maybe 2 or 3 years down the road, and you have the first child and the second child, and then what happens? That's when the tension starts rising, and their love will be put to test. What does it mean? How they understand the relationship is a little become different right now. You ask a woman who's been married for the past 15 years to her husband, and you tell her, if you guys always fight over these issues, tiny little issues, you always fight over these issues. Why are you still staying in this relationship? Why wouldn't you just go out and just find your divorce and then live your life? She goes, because I feel sorry for him. I'm afraid if I divorce him, he's so clumsy, he won't be able to take care of himself. Isn't this love? But it's mercy. She's staying with him out of mercy. This relationship is running with mercy, ya jama'ah. Same thing, you ask the guy, he says, ya akhi, if she's keeping you, annoying you and nagging you so much that you're so annoyed by that relationship, why don't you just get divorced and move on with your life? He says, ya akhi, just for the children. I just care for the children. I want the children to have both parents together, so I'm willing to suck it in and accept that situation for the sake of the children. Isn't this mercy? That's out of mercy. So love and mercy are the two things that keeps, you know, the relationship running. I'm not now saying that this is an ideal scenario to run on mercy, only on mercy. At the same time, I'm not saying to be idealistic and always run on love. You have to have them both in the relationship. And just for your knowledge, as you grow in the relationship, love will transfer itself from one level to the other. Slowly and gradually. It can last very long and can stay very short. And I'm a very strong believer that love can really fix the most broken relationship if we do understand it properly. No wonder Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this one of His great signs. In the ayah I'm reciting to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. And among His signs is this, that He has created for you, for one, yourselves, spouses, for yourself. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. So He says, from amongst His signs, this is one of His greatest signs. Signs about what and what in this creation? This ayah comes in the context of speaking about the creation of the heavens and the earth, the creation of man, the production of human beings, the different tongues and languages, the magnificent creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there in the middle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that one of these greatest signs of this creation, that He has created man and woman so they can get together in marriage and relationship so they find peace and tranquility with each other. Why? Based on love and mercy. He said this is one of the greatest signs. And then He said at the end of the ayat, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمَا وَادَةَ وَرَحْمَةَ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ. He said that you shall find signs therein for those who reflect. Again, bringing the word signs, ayat. So twice, He's telling you, there's a great secret in this kind of organization, that family organization, the relationship between husband and wife. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, mawaddata wa rahma, love and mercy, you can easily summarize them in two words, passion and compassion. How can we see that in real life? How can we translate that in real life? The best example The best example for us in this regard is whom, Jamal? Your father, right? Your father is your best example?
No.
Your mother?
No.
How about your grandfather?
No.
Why are you guys so prejudiced against it without bringing up your parents? Because, you know, there's something wrong in that. SubhanAllah, in our culture, in our traditions, as Muslims, and even human beings in general, kids grow up learning one pattern. What pattern is that? Their own parents' pattern. The boy sees how his father treats his mother. How do you expect him to treat his wife when he grows older? Based on what he learned, what he has seen. The woman, she sees how her mother was treated, and how her mother treats her father, so she grows up basically learning that. That was in traditional societies. Guess what? It has changed. My dear parents, you need to understand, it has changed. Because your kids right now, they have more than one outlet to learn about many things. Besides just having you and your mother and the spouse as the source of education, they're learning through the TV, through readings, through the internet, through other friends. They're always outside. They spend more time outside, whether on campus and massaging activities, wherever they go, more than they would spend time with you to learn from you. So expecting your children, by virtue of being under your roof, living under your roof, to grow up the way you want them to be, you'll be dreaming. So you need to wake up and make sure that you have a nice line of communication with your children so that you understand how to communicate love to them, inshallah ta'ala, and for them in that relationship. Again, this ayah will tell us, of course, this is now one of the greatest secrets. And the best person that from whom we learn the secret or how to apply that will be the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What people they want to see in a relationship, they want to see many things, many qualities. And I would like to share with you some of the examples of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's lifestyle. A lot of Marganiyah. Okay.
Just go ahead.
What I would like to share with you is just the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived his life as a great man, as a great family man, salawatullahi wasallam. I'm sure that whenever we hear the word Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is the first image that comes to the mind in regard of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life? The Messenger of Allah. That's what comes to you. It comes to your mind as a great personality, character. But as a great man who sacrificed everything he had for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to deliver the message of Allah azza wa jal, so that you today in the 21st century, somewhere in the middle of New Jersey, in the middle of subhanAllah, all this whole urban areas, and you're saying, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Can you imagine this? If you look around, you have mashallah nice diversity of it. But still, you would all say, you all share the same common ground, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. The Prophet ﷺ didn't just live his life as a messenger. He was a human being even before he was a messenger. ﷺ. Didn't Allah Azza wa Jal say to him at the end of Surah Al-Kahf, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ. Say, O Muhammad, say to them, Ya Muhammad, إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ. I am a human being. That's what he was instructed to say. He was a human being. But then some of you might say, I agree, Shaykh, he was a human being, but he was a superior human being, superhuman. That's why we can't do what he did. No. In order to dispel all these actually claims and apprehensions about this issue, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed him to say immediately, مِثْلُكُمْ, just like you. Which means, إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ, I am a human being just like you. So no one would have an excuse to say, yeah, he was a human being, but you know, he was different. He was the prophet, he was this, he was that. All these lame excuses not to follow his example can be thrown out the window because of this word, مِثْلُكُمْ, just like you. The only difference, يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ, that is simply revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he was a great messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his aspect, his practice of the human aspect of his life is part of the tradition that we all obligated to follow. As human beings, we need to follow that example. How did he live his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a family man? The Prophet ﷺ lived his life as, he lived his life ﷺ as a father. He lived his life as a son before he became even a father. He lived his life as a husband ﷺ. He lived his life as a friend So he had different and multiple roles, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that society. How can we all relate ourselves to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life? Let's see that together, inshaAllah. First of all, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the son. Who was his mother, Jama?
Amen.
Amen. How old was he when she died?
Six
years old. Barely, he could barely remember her. And I'm sure many of us might share this feeling right now. Say, subhanAllah, I mean, imagine yourself growing up a child when there's no father, no mother around you. I'm sure there are people who have this experience in their lives. But most of the people would have the pleasure of having both parents around when they were growing up. Some, they might be tested by having one missing for a reason or another. But overall, subhanAllah, imagine like the Prophet ﷺ growing up, no mother around him. However, when he became Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he never forgot about his mom. 6 years old, what would he remember from that time that he spent with his mother? Still, when he became a Messenger of Allah and he went to Medina, his mother was buried somewhere out there in the outskirts of the area of Medina. So he asked for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him permission to seek forgiveness for her. His mom, she died before Islam. So assume that she was not Muslim. And therefore, when you ask for permission to seek forgiveness for her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said no. He was not given the permission to seek forgiveness for his mother, to make dua for her basically. He said no, no dua for your mother. But then he asked, okay, at least grant me the permission to visit her grave. And he was given that permission. So he takes a journey, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He basically goes to visit the grave of his mother. That's the way he could at least meet with her. She's dead. So he visit her grave. And he took a group of Sahaba with him. They went with him, accompanying him to the side of the grave of his mother. And as he was standing there, I want you to visualize that scene right now. This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, after the migration. Can you guess his age?
53.
The Prophet ﷺ, when he immigrated to Medina, how old, first of all, when he received the first revelation, how old was he?
40.
How long did he stay in Mecca before immigration?
13.
What is this right now? 53. He went to Medina. He spent at least 2, 3, 4 years. So you're talking about someone who's close to 60 years old. 60 years old, and he still remembers his mother. We have people who are younger than that, and they're so cruel when it comes to talking about their parents, their mothers, their fathers, their grandparents. They're so cruel. Their hearts are so cold. Their feelings are so, they're so dead when it comes to talking about their parents and their mother and their fathers. La ilaha illallah. Here's Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's 60, close to 60 years old. And he still remembers his mother, who did not, he cannot even recollect memories more than 6 years of his tender age, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of which he could never even remember more than 2 years. The last 2 years, perhaps he could remember them. Anything besides that, he was too young to remember anything about her. Still, in his late 50s, he remembers his mother, and he wants to visit her grave. Today, people, we have so many people can't even come closer to this. So he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, motivated to the extent that he wanted to go and visit her grave. So he goes there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as he was standing there, knowing that the one who was lying underneath this pile of dirt was his beloved mother, Amina. Not being able to make that dua he wanted to do for her, he felt emotional. He was overwhelmed that he starts crying. Again, visualize that. A man in his 50s, close to 60 years old, and he's crying. About what? About the loss of his mother. Salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. His crying, his tears, made those around him start crying as well. They start crying for his crying. La ilaha illallah. And she was dead. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed you today to live and learn about this story. What are you going to do about your parents, your mother, and your father? What are you going to do about them? A man came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, Ya Rasulullah, man haqqu nasi bi husn sahabati? Who's entitled to the best companionship in my life? To whom should I give the best companionship in this life? He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, your wife. Right?
No.
What did he say?
Your mother.
As your mother, are you sure?
No.
He says, your wife.
No, your mother.
Your mother. Is it your mother?
No.
So why don't we see most people, they say, your wife. Your wife. Your wife. And then your wife. Same thing to the wife. They say, your husband. What about, leave room, ya jama'ah. The Prophet ﷺ, when this man came to him and he said, who is entitled to the best companionship? He said, your mother. I mean, the man did not perhaps expect that answer because he was asking about what? But friendship, companionship. So the Prophet told him, you know, your mother. He was expecting your wife. Because we talk about companionship, what do people have in their mind? Longer companionship, some sort of, you know, relations that were outside their normal relationship that we all know. So when he got the first answer, he was shocked. He said, your mother. So he said, then? So he said, Ya Rasulullah, thumma man, who comes next? The Prophet says, your mother. And the man is kind of puzzled. Did the Prophet ﷺ hear the question? Or is he repeating himself? So he's doubtful. He said, okay, so who's next? The Prophet ﷺ says, your mother. That's when he realized, so purposely he was repeating the word, your mother. Then he said, okay, Rasulullah, who comes next? That's when he said, your father. The man didn't ask anymore. You know why? Because that's it. The circle is full. The square is full. When you divide that, four quarters, we're done. Three quarters to your mother, and one quarter to your father. So if you have your parents alive, wallahi, you should do every possible thing that you could do to bring happiness to their hearts in this world. Because Al-Jannah, as the Prophet ﷺ says, Thumb, Jannah, entering the gate to paradise, are there underneath their feet. It's just right there. Easy access. Subhanallah. And if you lost any one of them, still not too late. The Prophet ﷺ, he was asked a question, what can I do? مَاذَا بَقِي مِنْ بِرِّي وَلِدَيَّ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهِمَا. How can I still be dutiful to my parents even long after they're gone? The Prophet, he gave the instruction that you maintain the same thing that you do to maintain for them before they die. Like keeping good companionship to their friends, giving charity on their behalf, making dua for them, and again, keep good ties with their kinship, the kinship. And their family and relatives. So you maintain that, and you'll get the same reward as if they were alive. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did that, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And when he arrived in Medina, everybody was fighting to get the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to stay with him. Guess where he chose sallallahu alaihi wasallam to stay? Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. You know why? Because he was related to his mother. He was from his uncles, from Akhwali, Bani Najjar. So he still kept that in mind, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he first arrived in an area like Yathrib al-Madinah al-Munawwar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then he grew up, after he became, was a young child, and he got married to Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. Subhanallah, when we study the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, nothing much we really know about the kind of life the Prophet ﷺ had with his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. Nothing much really. Comparing to how much we know about that relationship with Aisha radiallahu anha, otherwise with the Prophet ﷺ. So we don't know that much really, subhanAllah. However, the little that we know about the Prophet ﷺ and his feelings towards Khadija speaks volume. Volume! And that shows you the kind of relationship, the love and mercy they had in that beautiful relationship. Salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. When Khadija radiallahu anha was there, she was a very intelligent man. So kind, so passionate and compassionate that whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in stress and distress, he runs after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to his beloved wife Khadija radiallahu anha, and he would feel welcome, and he would always be encouraged and encouragement from her. Imagine that every man in this world comes back stressed out from work, he finds this encouraging environment in the house. Now the ladies, they say, but bring me Muhammad Rasulullah first, and I'll be Khadija for him. And I agree with you 100%. I agree with you 100%. Because most men demand Khadija in their houses, where they're not even coming closer to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Even the youngest Sahabi radiallahu anhum wa Allah. So it's a mutual effort on both ends. Don't just take these ahadith and start saying, see what the Prophet said? Both of us, it's a mutual effort. Both ends, we have to work so hard to bring love and mercy to that relationship. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he loved Khadija so much that whenever people come, when Aisha, even one of the most beloved to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when she touched or talked about Khadija by in any way, that he felt it was hurtful to Khadija, long after she was dead, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would stop her there. Aisha was the most beloved. When he was asked, Ya Rasulullah, who is the most beloved to you? He said, Aisha. Straightforward means, do you need to ask a question? There's no question about that. So it's very obvious. However, when Aisha says something about Khadija, the Prophet ﷺ gets very upset. One time, the Prophet ﷺ, he received a gift of meat, goat meat based perhaps, and for distribution. So the Prophet ﷺ, in the presence of Aisha, he started ordering the meat to be cut and given to the friends of Khadija. To send this to the friend of Khadija, send this to the son. So well, she was a good friend of Khadija. Basically, he's keeping connection with friends of Khadija for the sake of his wife, radiallahu anha. Aisha was there, kind of felt jealous a little bit. Jealous from whom? A woman who was already dead. But she just felt so jealous. At least her mention was kind of irritating. So she said, Ya Rasulullah, I mean, why do you keep mentioning this old lady after she became dust in her grave when Allah has given you such and such, you know, beautiful maiden, lady about herself? And that's when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he stopped and he said that. Never say that again about Khadija. Says never. And then he starts counting the qualities of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala. She was the one who supported me when everybody left me alone. She was the one who gave me comfort. She sacrificed her time. She sacrificed even, he said, her money and her wealth. Fi sabilillah. She was the one radiallahu ta'ala anha. She basically, he was telling her, she was everything for me when everybody else was away, turning away from me. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ maintained so much loving relationship with Khadija. He never got married actually during that time at all, except to Khadija radiallahu anha. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was very faithful in that relationship. And also as well for in other relationships, salawatullahi wa sallam, which we're going to talk about later. But now for Khadija radiallahu anha, imagine that you visualize that model in your life. Both husband and wife, they get together. You know what brought them together besides just the loving relationship they had? Wallahi, it's that ultimate goal that they all seek is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came down from the cave of Hira, shivering and shaking, and she wrapped him, she said, it's okay. He told her, khiftu ala nafsi, I was so scared for myself. What did she say about him? She says, kalla wallahi la yafzik Allahu abada, no way. Allah will never disgrace you. Subhanallah, look at this woman, how she stands by her husband in time of difficulty like this and said, no, I know you. She knew him from before he received the revelation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for more than 15 years right now. And she was counting his good qualities. You're such a good person. You maintain good relations with your families, you help the poor, you always, you know, around there when people need you. So she was counting his qualities. She knew about the qualities of her husband, she supports him. She says, no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not disgrace you. And indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made her the messenger of Allah. So what did she do in return to this? She became the first believer. Radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha. Allahumma ardha an Khadija radiallahu anha. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha a place in al-Jannah that no one else, no woman will get anything like this. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Khadija, he had all his children except for Ibrahim alayhi salam. Just all his children except for Ibrahim. So we don't know much really about the relationship between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his children when they were young kids. But we know so much as they started growing older. SubhanAllah, one of these beautiful and amazing feelings, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the father, he was like anyone else, like any other man. like any other man. You love your children, you take care of them, you protect them, and guess what? You hate to lose them during your lifetime, don't you? How many of you would love to lose his children during this lifetime? Anyone? No one. You all love to see your kids to grow up to become, mashallah, of their age. You see, mashallah, the result of your work in this dunya, hopefully in the akhirah, to be positive, inshallah ta'ala. So you all love that. And here's Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was watching his children dying one after the other during his lifetime. First, his baby boys. Al-Qasim wa Abdullah, they died in infancy. Whenever I remember these stories, wallahi, it just amazing how he had to endure all these feelings and hardships as a great messenger of Allah. As a test. And if anyone who deserved to be spared, if anyone deserved to be spared the pain of losing a child, should be Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not spared that pain. So what about you? If something wrong happens to your child, you start complaining. You start whining about it. Something wrong happens between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, between you and your child, you start complaining and blame Allah azza wa jal for that. Why? And here's Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, never complained about this. Then his daughters, one after the other, dying in his lifetime. Ruqayya, Ummu Kulthum, the wife of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then when he went, and also in Medina afterwards, Zainab al-Kubra, his eldest daughter, she dies. And as the ladies were preparing her, he came and approached him. He says, when you're done washing her and preparing her, call me. Just call me before you start wrapping her. So when they washed her and prepared her, they gave the Prophet that they're ready. So he gave them his outer garment, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, please wrap her with this. I want her to be blessed with that. So they wrapped her with that. And when they brought her to the grave, Rasulullah was there crying. Crying as he was burying his own daughter, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And who was that? That was the bikr to him, which means it's the first child. The first child by whom he earned the title of a father, salallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can you imagine losing your child like this? Subhanallah. Then the only child that left and survived the Prophet salallahu alayhi wa sallam was Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha wa Allah. Fatima radiallahu anha, she brought the joy of the world to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Personally, and then with her children, Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn. You see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every time he sees Fatima, he stops everything that he was doing. And he would go straight to greet her. He would stand up for her sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would kiss her on her forehead radiallahu ta'ala anha wa Allah. And he brings her to sit next to him as close as possible. And as he speaks, he always pays attention to her and what she says. He was very good listener, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How many times you had a child coming to you, says, Baba, Mom, and as they start speaking, you interrupt them. Why? Because, come on, leave me on these silly things, yeah. I have much more important things to care about than just nagging and bickering between you and your siblings. Go and solve it on your own. I'm done with this. All these kind of, argument that you have with your children. When was the last time you just stopped for your five-year-old child and you listened to them as they speak whatever words they learned so far to speak to explain a complex situation to you? Because at least to them. When was the last time? You know, the story of Yusuf alayhi salam begins by the event of the dream. That Yusuf, he saw him when he was a child. And he went to his father, he says, قَالَ يَا أَبَتِي إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا وَالشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ رَأَيْتُهُمْ لِي سَاجِدِينَ. You know, if you check the Arabic expression, it's so beautiful, subhanAllah. قَالَ يَا أَبَتِي, he says, oh my father. The word يَا أَبَتِي is not like saying dad. It's not like saying dad. It's much more beautiful. Like saying daddy. Daddy, يَا أَبَتِي, daddy. When you say daddy, who says daddy? 13 years old say daddy to you? No way, right? When they pass maybe 5 years old, 6 years old, they stop saying daddy. They stop saying dad, whatever. Call you by name then. Here's Yusuf alayhi salam as a young child coming to his father. He says, Ya Abati, daddy, daddy. Qala ya Abati, inni ra'aytu ahada ashara kawkaban. I've seen 11 planets. Kawkaban. Wa shamsa wal qamar, I've seen the sun and the moon. Ra'aytum, I saw them. word, I saw them prostrating to me or before me. You know when a child speaks, they repeat themselves a few times as they talk, right? That's why they say, that's why he said, قَالَ يَا أَبَتِي, oh, daddy, daddy, إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ, I have seen, and then he said, and I have seen them. Again, they repeat themselves more than one time. That's how children speak. Daddy, daddy, and they repeat that again. So I heard that. Move on. They repeat that again. And they mention the same thing over and over again. But still, Yaqub, alayhi salam, he was listening carefully to his child, and he gave him positive feedback. When was the last time you talked to your child and you give them a feedback that made them feel good instead of giving them instructions? Go and do this, don't do that again. When was that? Why do we break all these lines of communication with our children? Rasulullah was always a good communicator. Salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. Fatima, even she remembers him when he was giving her this special attention, moments basically. Quality time. She was in the presence of the other wives, specifically Aisha radiallahu anha, and that was close to the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as they were speaking, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he paid attention to Fatima, so he whispers something in her ear. See, just, I want you to visualize that right now. They're sitting together in the session, with Aisha there, Fatima there, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he leans towards Fatima, and he starts whispering something in her ear. Suddenly, Fatima breaks in tears, starts crying. Then the Prophet said he felt so bad that he broke her heart because of what he said. So he just goes up back again, and he whispers something else to her. So she starts giggling. Because she starts holding her tears, and then she starts laughing. And then he finishes with a smile. Now, everybody, I'm thinking right now, you guys are dying to know what was that all about, right? Aisha, the same thing. She was there. The moment Fatima was leaving, she went to escort her out, and then she said, by the way, what was that all about? The crying, the laughing. She told her, no, that's the secret of the Prophet, I'm not going to say. Then, a few days maybe later, the Prophet passed away. Allahu alam, how long did it take Aisha to return back to Fatima, telling her now that the Prophet was gone, so now tell me, what was that all about? She told her, the Prophet he whispered to me, that he is going to be leaving very soon. And suddenly she starts crying because of that. But then to make her feel good, the Prophet ﷺ gave her the news that, don't worry. Don't you want to be one of the fair ladies of Al-Jannah? Of course, I mean, everybody wants to be like that, like being the first lady of Al-Jannah. Can you imagine that title? So she started laughing, giggles. My God, of course I want to. So she stopped. Another narration, he gave her the news that she is going to be following him soon. 6 months after he passed away, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Fatima was gone. His grandchildren, Hassan and Hussein. You know, as a man, in his profession, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a great leader, a great messenger of Allah, a great politician, educator, you name it, everything you can think of in his life, that was him, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And even in your life. However, even though with this so busy schedule, he would have time to go and spend some time with his kids, with Hassan and Hussein. They used to say about Rasulullah that if he was missing in action, they were looking for him and he wasn't there, says most likely you'll find him in the house of Fatima. Sure enough, one time Umar al-Khattab was looking for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said that he's not there. In the masjid, no, he's not in the masjid. So he said, where should we find him? So go to the house of Fatima, he must be there. So he goes to the house of Fatima. And what does he do over there? What do you think he's doing in the house of Fatima radiallahu ta'ala? Giving orders and commands?
Play with the kids.
No. When Umar, he came in and he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was such an amazing sight. He sees the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his knees, four, playing horsey with Hassan al-Hussein. Can you imagine the whole ummah is waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's playing horsey? So then when Umar, he saw that, he just made a comment. He said, says, MashaAllah, Ni'mal rakub wa rakubukuma. So he has such a fancy ride, MashaAllah. And the Prophet said, in response to this, he said, and they are the best knights who can ever ride on this ride. Al-Hasan Hussein, radiallahu ta'ala, joking about it. He was joking about it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Umar would tell him, Ya Rasulullah, we need you. So then the Prophet said, we'd take Al-Hasan Hussein down, and he would go and attend these serious matters. So even the Messenger of Allah, I'm sure some people say, Ya Shaykh, you just damaged the image that I had about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I couldn't even imagine the Prophet would be on four playing horses with the children. Why not? Why not? Is it because you don't do it? Or are you too old for this? Ah. And guess how old was he when he was doing that? He was already in his 60s. He was already in his 60s, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was doing that, salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi. So if you're still in your 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s, you're still younger than the Prophet, he did that. So don't say, I can do this. No, this is not my style, actually. I don't want my kids basically to be literally right on my back and in my life. Said, why do you take it that way? You're acting like this Bedouin, who one time came to the Prophet ﷺ and the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he received him as the head of his delegation. His name was Al-Aqra ibn Habis. He was the head of his tribe, basically. Can you imagine like a position, such a high position like this? So the Prophet takes him to honor the guest of such a status to come to the house, and he went to the house on his way to the house. He stopped by the house of Fatima. So let's just stop for a few minutes here, just I want to see the kids and we go. And he stops, subhanAllah, he stops with that guest so he could receive the children. And when Fatima radiallahu anha, she heard the Prophet calling them, he used to call them, says, Athamma Luka, Athamma Luka. Luka is just like a kind word for kids, like saying, where is that weasel and where is that such a chance? This kind of nice word. So she was holding the kids, and when it was time, she released them, they came running to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as they jumped on him, salawatullahi wasalam alayhi, there was a report that he would hold their hands and they would be climbing on his legs, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can you imagine that? He's standing and holding their hands, and they would be climbing with their feet on his legs, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, until they get to the level of his chest, and then he hugs them. Then he kissed them. So when he kissed the child, and he puts them down, that man was looking at Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and was kind of frowning on him. And he says, تُقَبِّلُونَ أَبْنَا. Do you kiss your children? Which means, are you serious? You do that? So the Prophet ﷺ was surprised and shocked. He says, of course. The man says, and he was proud of him as achievement. He, as a father, of course, he says, إِنَّ لِي عَشْرَةً مِنَ الْوَلَدِ. I have 10 children, I never kissed any one of them. So what should you say to him? Should say, all right. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, قَالَ وَمَا أَمْلِكُ أَنْ نَزَعَ اللَّهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ قَلْبِهِ. What can I do for you if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken mercy out of your heart? Because if you never touched your child in a positive way to encourage them, to show them kindness, mercy, tenderness, then you missed a lot. If you've never done that before, by the way, if your children are already past 10, 11, 12 years old, don't even try it right now. Take it easy. Don't go home and rush and say, my son, give me a He would say, excuse me, what's going on? Where have you been? I think we're in the masjid or something. Take it easy on them. If you haven't done it, if you didn't train them, if you did not grow up in the house feeling that love and that kindness and tenderness, it's never too late, by the way. It's never too late. But you need to start a good line of communication with your children, inshallah. Tabaraka wa ta'ala. Rasulullah was a great husband with his wife. Great husband. Some people, they complain about one relationship with one wife. Imagine the Prophet, he had 9 wives, Jemaah. When he passed away, he had 9 wives, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And alhamdulillah, his relationship with his wives was like any other relationship. It goes up and down. There'll be some issues that you call it, you know, complaints, talking too much, nagging, too demanding, all these things. They all happened in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And women might complain also about their husband, saying, you know, what I hate the most about him is his silent treatment. When he wants to act like the man, so he doesn't talk at all. He's almost silent. Said, do you want to eat? He's so quiet. Okay, fine. If you don't want to eat, it's in the fridge. So why? Why do we act like this? It's normal. In our life, it would happen. We're human beings. A man has his ego, he has his pride, and the woman, she feels hurt, not being cared for, and so on. And it affects the relationship. Where is that love and mercy that Allah mentioned in the Quran? It's by choice that, unfortunately, we try to avoid treating each other fairly. So here's Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has multiple occasions with his wife when he had some issues like this. One of these issues, they will always gather whenever they hear about the news that they received war spoils. means that there is money coming in. And when there is money coming in, what does that mean? Extra cash. MashaAllah, I heard that you got bonus this month, tabarakallah. So where's my cut in that check? You'll get it inshallah someday, with Allah Azza wa Jalla. So they always want more. Why? Because they love to change things in it to make them better. That's the nature of women, subhanAllah. Men, they act differently. If things are running, alhamdulillah, and they're okay, don't touch them. Don't even try to start, otherwise everything will be ruined. Never. See, that's how we think as men. If you drive your car, you don't even think of regular maintenance until the light goes on the check engine. That's when you stop to go and check it out. That's what happens in marital relationship as well. Most women, they like to check in every now and then. Every few weeks, perhaps every few days, perhaps every few hours. They might check, is everything okay? They would like to reconnect and communicate. And for a man, this is very irritating. He says, we're fine, what's wrong with you? I want to make sure everything is okay, inshallah. And the man, on the other hand, if everything is okay, if she's not complaining, if she's not talking, alhamdulillah, we're fine. That means she has no problem, she has no complaint. And guess what? When she starts complaining, he says, Ya Allah, she complains too much, Allah musta'an. So whether she needs to remain silent or basically talk everything at the same time. Because we're not communicating properly with each other. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when his women, when his wife used to listen, hearing about the news that there's more money coming in, they would gather around him and say, Ya Rasulullah, we need you know, our share. And the Prophet would tell them, there's not my money. It's the money of the Ummah. I cannot give you some more. You got your share. That's it. It's over right now. They demand that the Prophet says, I cannot. They demand, they say, I cannot. One time, Umar ibn Khattab and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, they came in when they overheard his women talking, you know, too loud to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet was so patient with them. Then when they came in, all the women basically, they just kept quiet. One of these occasions, Umar ibn Khattab, he says, Ya aduwati anfusikum. You're such an enemy against yourselves. You know, you hear, you're speaking over the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when I come in, you remain quiet. So one of them answered him so that she was very actually encouraged in her response. And she goes, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is very nice, basically. She's what, that's the essence of what she said. And you are very rude. Basically, when you talk, you're rough and tough, and we don't deal with you. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is very nice. He said, okay. He's okay with that, meaning, get out of it. Just leave it for us. So Umar ibn Khattab, he was defeated, so he just left. In another occasion, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he got to the point, the breaking point, that he had to swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to approach his wives for an entire month. That happens, and that's what women call the silent treatment. So he decided to stop communicating with them for a whole month, an entire month. It was too much for him, overwhelming. It does happen. So like a discipline, you know, to the kind of to the family. I warn men from taking this hadith as a technique in your relationship. I'm warning you. Because you first need to define the kind of relationship you have and the line of communication, and then you can basically both use these techniques, men and women. So the Prophet ﷺ, he goes out from the house of Aisha, and he stays in a loft that was built over the house of Aisha radiallahu anha. Umar, when he heard the news, he was panicked, because his daughter was the wife of the Prophet. So he went to Hafsa, and he says, what's going on? Did he divorce you? He said, I don't know. So what did he do? Where is he? I don't know. He went to the masjid. So he went looking for the Prophet and he found him up there. Bilal was guarding the stairway. He says, can you ask permission for me? So Bilal goes up and then he talks to the Prophet. So there's Umar seeking permission. And the Prophet says, basically he remained silent. Even that silent treatment with Umar. So he remained quiet. Then Umar, he just sat down and he just waited. He did that three times. And the last time he got permission. So he goes up. And he sees the Prophet ﷺ leaning on his side, and he looked very upset. You know when men look very upset, women, they can see that, right? They can see through. Even if you're not actually trying to fake it, they know. So eventually, he saw the Prophet was very upset, so he didn't dare sit down. He starts communicating with the Prophet until the Prophet smiled, and then he sat down. Then he asked the question, he dared ask him the question, did you divorce them? The Prophet said, no, I just basically, I gave an oath not to approach him for an entire month. At the end of the month, it was 29 days. The lunar calendar could be 30 days or 29 days, right? So at the end of the 29 days, the Prophet ﷺ, he comes down. Can you guess which house would he start with?
Aisha.
I mean, that shows you how he himself, when he said a month, maybe he thought, oh, that's too much. But eventually, he went straight to the house of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And a man always expects his wife, after such a disciplinary session for an entire month, to be more obedient, submissive, and so on. That's what he expects. So he goes to the house of Aisha. And Aisha, instead of calling, you may expect her to say, I'm very sorry, I didn't mean it, no, please forgive me, and so on. She said to him, so the month is not over yet. Which means there are 29 days, there's still one more day. Some of the ufuqaha, they tried to philosophize the story by saying, well, Aisha, she was concerned for the practice of the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, there's one more day, so you need to go back again up there. Say, Ya Akhi. The Aisha, she was kind of, basically, she was very upset herself too. I mean, do you expect Aisha for 29 days sitting there just crying and weeping that the Prophet ﷺ is not there at home? She cried for some time, for sure, but then she herself, you know, just like another woman, she feels that, yeah, I didn't do that. I didn't do what to deserve all of this, basically. And that's what happens between a husband and wife, which requires to open again line of communication between husband and wife, to talk and get things out in the most appropriate way, inshallah ta'ala. So the Prophet, patient, not like today, many would say, okay then, salamu alaikum, and you leave. He said, no, he said, the month can be like this, saying 29 days, and can be like this, in 30 days. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we have seen from these hadith and stories, he was the great father, he was a great son, he was a great husband. And there is much more to be said about the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We can, wallahi, talk about this yani for an entire night, another night. I've given a whole seminar for a weekend on a subject like this. Just about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the akhlaq and the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is just now a glimpse of what we can really get from this ocean of knowledge that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have left for us in terms of teaching, treating our spouse in the most appropriate way. There is so much we can learn from the Prophet ﷺ, more than just salah, siyam, and giving the zakah. You can learn from his akhlaq and his manners, and that's what he was sent for us sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Kana khuluqul Quran, his manners was the Quran itself. And through, of course, his techniques of dealing with his wives and children, grandchildren, we can learn so much about teaching each other, treating each other in the best way possible. I know actually there's much more we can mention about this issue, and I would love to leave inshallah a few more minutes for question and answers. But as a message that I would like to share with you at the end of this talk is remind you going back again to the ayah that we started with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنْ آيَاتٍ among his signs is this. This is one of his signs, the creation of man and woman, and bring them together in order to create this peace, tranquility, and serenity in the relationship. And he placed love and mercy between our hearts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after that, again he said, there are signs. Signs are therein for those who reflect. This is a miracle. Wallahi, the creation of man and woman, establishment of the society, it's a miracle. This is divine organization, divine institution. And you have the choice to become manifestation of this miracle, or otherwise. You choose for yourself, and the best choice is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for you. Wallahu alam, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
I have possibly implement some of the suggestions and the nasiha that was given. So inshallah, we'll open the floor for questions. I think we'll probably just go by a raise of hands, probably give the sisters a first shot at it. And then, inshallah, we have like about 15 minutes of questions. Then, inshallah, 15 minutes. So, inshallah. Probably,
yeah. Who's going to dare to ask the first question? Bismillah.
Sheikh, JazakAllah khair for the wonderful lecture. First question is that, if you could give us some advice on, how to discipline the children when they're going through the terrible twos and threes.
No. Question, how to discipline children when they're going through the terrible two and three. Welcome to the club. I've been there many times, alhamdulillah. So dealing with this, the kids of that age, first and foremost, the most important thing for you parents that when you teach your children, teach them discipline. Teach them discipline. And you teach them discipline through principles. Through principles. And you don't break these principles. Like what? One of the things that I've seen, in, it's a cultural thing. Whenever some parents, you have kids around together, there will be a lot of mischievous actions. You have to expect that. Don't expect them to mashallah to get there and they will mashallah do qiyamul layl and they're not going to do that. It's going to be like a zoo sometimes in these rooms. So you expect accidents. Kids bumping into each other, you expect something to be broken, whatever, you expect these accidents. Some parents, they subhanAllah, they, whenever they have guests coming over, when they visit people, they expect everything to be perfect. And because they get irritated when things like this happen, they stop going to visit other people. They stop going, taking their children out because they're always bringing troubles for us and so on. Wallahi, if parents are going to get upset because kids are fighting with each other, I feel sorry for these parents. Because kids, they're going to fight right now, and as you fight over their fight, they'll be playing again. So teach them principles. One of the main and most important principles is honesty. Now when something happens in a room like this, kids are playing together in the backyard, they break something. When an adult comes in to see what's going on, guess what is the first question an adult usually asks? You see something broken, what do you say? So, who did that? And guess what? You have 20 kids, what will they say? He did it. And if you try to judge between, if you try to reason with children, so one at a time, okay, tell me what happened. And then they start, no, that's not true, they're cutting each other. You're not going to get to the truth from the children. So stop trying to figure out who did it. Teach them a value. Instead of saying, who did it, ask one simple question. What happened? And let them talk. You don't have to listen to everything they say because you're not going to make any reasonable connection. Simply just teach them that you're not after who did it as much as just understand why this happened. And we can reconcile. But in our culture, you say, who did it? Children are very honest. So when you say, who did it? The one who did it usually say, I did it, but I didn't mean it. Then you reward them. How do you reward them? By punishment. Guess what you teach your children? The value that you're teaching your children. Never ever tell the truth. Understand? If you tell the truth, that's what you get. Your kid got the point right. So next time when something like this happens, that's when you start seeing fingers going all over the place. He did, because everyone wants to get away. Because you taught them the wrong value. So teach them discipline. Expect children to be basically troublemakers, in a sense, because that's the age. That's their age, 2 or 3 years old. They're very active in the phase of exploring. Encourage that for them, inshallah ta'ala. Another thing I want to teach you to make sure that never, ever use these electronic free babysitting. They're not even free, you buy them. You call them TV, you call them video games, and all that stuff. Don't use these technologies to tame your children because you just want to have a peace of mind. Most mothers, unfortunately, that's what they do. When the child becomes troublemaker, getting, let's say, irritated, they turn the TV on and they put the child over there. Well, I've seen kids 3 years old, glued to the TV and he's watching like this. You talk to the child, he's not there at all. He feels sorry. I knew a child, his family, they had a huge screen. You know, one of these huge, literally huge screen, theater screens, as if the TV is watching you, not watching the TV. The image on the screen is louder than you. So the kid is sitting there on one of these big couches, they're made for laziness, basically, lazy boy. Sitting there and watching. And then he grabbed the child, who was 3, 4 years old, and I saw him grabbing the remote control and just flipping channels. What do you expect the child to see when he flips channels like this? Clean stuff? No way. One night, we were in the masjid praying Salatul Isha, and I was the imam. Suddenly, we heard this kid in the back cursing and cussing bad words in English. Basically, his culture speaks other language. But eventually, it was pure English language, no accent. And he was saying the worst, and I didn't know what to do, Jama'at. To break salah, finish quickly, because you do the sahu, you don't know what's going on. SubhanAllah, the moment we finished Salat al-Isha, the father, I know the time, the father grabbed his son and he ran away. People were looking at each other saying, wow, what was that? Allah musta'an, an obscenity in Salat al-Isha, never heard of that before. So when I met the guy, I said, Yahi, tell me, what happened? Tell me, literally, what exactly happened? I said, this is what you get when you put your child in front of TV that much. That's what he's learning. He's not learning from you. He's learning from the TV. And same thing the mother. She doesn't want to bother dealing with the child. Just throw him in front of the TV, glue him in front of the TV, and she minds her own business, whatever she's doing. Whether something right or wrong, it doesn't matter now. But at least the wrong is being done against this child. So don't ever keep your children in front of the TV. So my advice to you, if you ever have a TV at home, don't put it in a central location. If you go to houses these days, most of TVs, they replaced the system of Hubal back in the Arabian Peninsula. You know what Hubal is? It's the Arab idols that the world Arab used to worship. How people, when you come into the house that they worship idol worshippers, where do you see these idols? In the central location. And you have entertainment center for it, mashallah, like a shrine and all these decorations on the side of the shrine. And then when you come in, you have to give respect to the God, the new God of the house and all the stuff. That's how it is. And you have all these fancy chairs so people can watch together. That's the wrong setup for the TV. You make it a center on the life of the family. Instead, the TV should be, if you have it, should be actually in a non-central location. My recommendation is to be in a very awkward angle even from the house. So that whoever is going to be watching it, they won't have any chairs in front of them. Sit like in front of the TV. They have to go on the floor, for example, very awkward as they watch. So they watch for a few minutes and then they leave. That's the whole purpose of it. Because you don't want the TV to be a central thing in your life. That's my recommendation for your children, inshallah ta'ala. Yes?
Inshallah. One second. Inshallah, there's a question here from the sisters. Can you comment on the cultural practice where the son feels his duties is to take care of his parents alone and not her parents? Basically, the idea that God has no duty to her parents. And then the second part of it is elaborate on when young people get married to be dutiful to both of them, inshallah. So the first one is that the cultural practice where, elaborate on the cultural practice where the son feels his duty is to care for his parents alone and not for her parents, his wife's parents.
So basically that the husband, he cares only for his own parents. He doesn't care about her parents. But who cares for her parents? The question, who cares for her parents?
He does.
We assume that she does or her brother. But if she has no brother, who's going to take care of her parents? She does. Okay, what if he doesn't allow her to work and there's no earning except his? How is she going to take care of her parents? I mean, if you make the logical consequence of this decision, you have to understand that her parents has become your parents by proxy. You should do that. And at the same time, your parents has become the way you want her to respect your parents because they're your parents and you're the man. You also need to respect her parents in return as well. And the idea of asking the question, wallahi, for me sometimes it's very irritating. The idea of just young men or women, they say, listen, I don't want anything to do with your parents. They talk to each other. Why? What's the problem? I mean, they are just like your parents. Sometimes they will just make your life difficult. Because they have their culture, you have your culture, so you come to some tension here. The same thing, her parents are going to make part of the life easy, and part of it might be actually some questionable things. So eventually, you need to respect them as your parents, and there is no escape. Literally, there is no escape. Yes, if they are a troublemaker, there's some other fitness happening, there's so much trouble that happens between husband and wife because of the parents, then my recommendation, go for counseling. Don't just be stubborn and say, no, I'm not going to even, if you have a problem, you go and ask the sheikh. So go for counseling. I'm not going to go for counseling. I would suggest that you go for counseling to solve that particular issue between you and your wife or your husband and the parents. But as general rule, you can't escape the fact that you have to respect them as the elders of our community. And by the way, the way you treat them, you'll be setting the example and the model for your children on how to treat you when you get older. Allah.
Well, the second part is just to elaborate on young people when they get married to make sure that they think about both sets of parents, the husband and the wife.
Yeah, this is the same thing. And when you get married, you're going to have to think of them again. You just the young men and women, they have this utopian ideas of marriage. That it's all about us, in me and you, and we live over the above the heavens, above the clouds, and inshallah everything is going to be perfect because we love each other. And then a few months after that, they have troubles. What happened? What happened? Maybe the clouds didn't have enough water in there? So eventually, you need to understand the reality of marriage is a complex relationship between you, parents, and other people related to that relationship. Yes, yes.
I want to ask a question. Sayyida Atta, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, several times she's getting married. And she was a martyr of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I want to know, because people want to know that things too. Why they feel it that Sayyida Umar Khattab, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was asking for a marriage, but she refused that. But I want to know, because you have a...
In terms of who's exactly which?
Sayyida Atika.
Atika?
Yes.
What's wrong with that?
No, she's the married 6 or 7 times in her life because the husband passed away in the war.
Yeah.
And then second time. I want to know.
Why women? Yes. Let me put it in perspective.
Yes.
Why women at the time of the Prophet and the Sahaba radiallahu anhu? Men and women would divorce and marry, and then it's basically wasn't a big problem back then. Today, it's unfortunately there's an inherited bias against divorcees or widows. It's basically, even when a lady hears a man, let's say he was married before, that's a question mark. If he failed it once, why not twice? So therefore, it becomes unfortunately inheriting the problem twice. Once it was transgressed against in the first relationship, if he was behind the victim. Second, by the label they put on him. In the community. Same thing with the lady. Why should we actually have this prejudice against each other, subhanAllah? We should understand marriage in perspective. Things didn't work out. Alhamdulillah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, Sahakum bi ma'ruf, wa tasrihum bi ihsan. You hold them nicely and release them nicely. Unfortunately, because marriage has become a great financial investment, that's what creates problems in families when divorce happen. I invested 100,000 in this marriage. And this one has put 25,000 in this night. So it becomes a source of problems. As for Atika, for example, she's not the only one. There's also, what's her name? Asma bint Hubaysh and Fatima bint Qais and other women. They married multiple times and there was no problem. Because the society was basically, if a man dies, she becomes a widow. After 4 months and 10 days, she's free to get married. Someone else is going to ask her for marriage. It was a norm back then. Our society has changed. Their view of marriage has changed, unfortunately. And I have to say actually frankly and openly, this culture or this bias against divorcees and widows and widowers and so on, it is among the immigrant community in America, the Muslim immigrant community in America. Among the reverts and the converts, there isn't that much of prejudice really about this issue. They have no problem. It's easy. Why? Because subhanAllah, I mean, the culture is different and the structure, their structure is like the structure of the Sahaba, the early Sahaba. They were all actually converts or mostly at that time. Wallahu a'lam. Now,
because also polygamy has become such a big taboo, you know.
Right now,
yeah, at least in this country, you know.
Could be, but I mean, what it has this to do with not accepting someone who's a widow or widower?
Well, there's like, wouldn't there be like only like one, like you have to when you get married.
Oh, you have to choose one and only one.
Yeah. So
it's because in this society, that's why it's become basically polygamy, marrying more than one wife is prohibited here.
Yeah.
So therefore, some people, they want to do it basically from the first time, do the right choice.
Yeah.
But that's not just here. Even Muslim world, the same thing. The subject of marrying more than one wife is actually in decline. It's not because it's prohibited, it's because it's personal choice. Allah. Yeah.
Inshallah, there are 3 more questions and we'll conclude. There's one about what someone texts about the duties to step-parents.
To the step-parents? The step-parents are the same thing. I mean, the step-parents, they will be like your parents in that sense as well. I mean, if you're growing up under the roof, of course, and they're taking care of you, so if your stepfather, he is like your father. And when I say like your father, I'd rather even eliminate the word like. Basically, he's a father. So you have to treat him like that. Don't say, well, he doesn't have the right to give me orders and commands. I know most children who grow up in this kind of relationship, they have an issue with that authority. So when the stepfather or stepmother tries to deal with them, they always resort to that issue. You're not my mother, you have no right to talk to me like this, you can't say this to me and so on. That's absolutely wrong. That's absolutely wrong. Yes, there are some specific, let's say, responsibility, or maybe specific responsibility of the parents if they are available, but they were divorced, for example. But overall, if you live under the roof again of the step-parents, then you should and you have to treat them like you treat your parents. Allah.
Inshallah, if we take the next question, take the internet.
Yeah, Florida. Okay. How do you get your children who are like 2, 3, and 4 to pray Salah with you?
How do you get your children 3, 2, 3, and 4
yeah, the young
to
children.
Pray with you? The 2, 3, or 4 children, basically. 2 years old, I think it's too young, even 3 and 4. SubhanAllah, the Prophet said, what the Prophet said in the hadith? He says, Muru awladakum bis salati li sabah. You command your children when to pray when they are 7. What do you guys understand from this? Usuli. What is mafhum al mukhalaf over here? If he said, you command them to pray when they're 7, what's the opposite understanding of this? Before 7, you can't command them. So in this case, teach them Salah before 7. That's what we also understand. Mm-hmm. We also understand from this that by the time you need to command them to pray, they already know how to do that. So you taught them Salah when they were 5, 6 years old. Children before that, they pray by, they learn through imitation. That's how they do it. They see you pray, they're going to pray. They see you watch TV, guess what? They're going to watch TV. So whatever you do, you're saying the example to your children. You read, they learn how to read. You read the Quran, they will learn how to read the Quran. I know a child, I knew a child, who was resisting learning the Quran, although his parents were so adamant to teach him the Quran. And one day I had a conversation with him. I said, why are you resisting? Why you don't want to learn? He says, because I don't see any reason for that. We don't even use it at home. No one practiced that at home. He said, are you willing to talk to your parents about this in front of me? He says, yeah, sure. So when his parents came, I said, I had them in conversation together. I said, this is what your son is saying. And his parents, they admitted, that is true. We don't really read the word. Everybody has excuse. I don't have time, this and that. I said, whatever excuse you have, your child doesn't see that. He only sees one thing, or per se the lack of it, which is not reading the Quran in the house. Allah. So teach them through good habits, inshallah.
Inshallah, before the next week, I was going to say prescription. Before the next week, question. Anyone else want to raise their hands? Then, in the meantime, one of the questions came. After Allah, who is the wife's next priority? Her parents, or in-laws, or husband?
That's the husband's question. My answer to this is seek counseling. You know the answer, but you want to use the answer to your wife by proxy. You already know the answer that the Prophet ﷺ, he gave the respect to the of the husband as a priority in the house of the wife. Basically, as a family, that's the arrangement. However, it's not, wallahi, it is not about authority as much as how you practice this beautiful relationship, love and mercy in the relationship. I mean, look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With a gesture, his wife would do him whatever he wants. It's not because he was just Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he was a loving man, a loving husband sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Troubles will always exist in the relationship. Expecting to have a faultless relationship, that's dream. It only happens in one place. You know what you call that place? Jannah. And you're on earth. Wake up. So therefore, you have to expect some errors, faults, problems, nice times, good times, hard times, difficult times. Didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ We shall test you and try you. بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالْتَّمَرَاتِ They'll be testing all these things. The lack of wealth, the decrease in of wealth and children and life and all that stuff. So prepare yourself. You're going to have to prepare yourself for that. Wallah. So again, it's not about who is the authority. This question really, it means that you have some issues that you guys need to resolve. Wallah. Go ahead.
What if your spouse's parents or in-laws are not Muslim and the father won't speak to either of you because of this situation.
If the let's say the in-laws, they're non-Muslims and they don't want to talk to you guys because of her becoming Muslim or him becoming Muslim, and he's marrying, you know, someone that they don't approve and so on, you do your best. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا, and keep good companionship with them. And he says that during difficult times. By the way, you don't show them companionship in good times. No, the best companionship is shown in difficult times. That's when you need to have good companionship with them. However, if they command you to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you do not obey them. Allah.
The next question is, what should we do about parents who are not like their daughters or sons to marry out of their race or culture? And does that mean that they should no longer get married?
Wow. No, the parents are already actually holding it in their hearts. Wallahi, whether we like it or not, our children are growing up in a culture different than their parents. If they were coming from an immigrant community, you know what, not even just coming from an immigrant actually background. Even if they were born here, even if they grew up over here, children every day are growing up learning other things, different styles, different culture than their parents' culture. Ali ibn Abi Talib, and that's my advice, Ali ibn Abi Talib, he gave an amazing statement about one of the greatest principles of child upbringing or raising. He said, "علموا أبناءكم أدبوا أبناءكم لزمانهم لا لزمانكم." He says, when you raise your children, basically he says, train them, raise them, or prepare them for the challenges of their time, not your time. Most of us, we want our kids to be copies, clones, basically, of ourselves. That's not going to happen. Whatever you try, it's not going to happen. Most parents, they want their children to be the continuation of their success story in life. Alhamdulillah, I immigrated 35 years ago, I became a successful doctor, I bought this fancy mansion, mashallah, and I made extra room for you and your wife when you get married, all this stuff, and then, excuse me, slow down, let's rewind a little bit. That was 35 years ago. Now we live in a different age. Parents need to understand that things are changing. Their kids, they have grown up, they're grown up right now, and they don't see these actually boundaries, the race, the color. Look at them. When they go on campus, they associate with people of all color, all race. In Muslim communities, when we have Eid party, you had Eid party, guys, or don't have Eid parties over here?
Yeah.
Alhamdulillah. If you have seen the Eid parties, most likely you have seen these actually these circles. So you have, mashallah, that the Arabs on one side, and you have the Daisies on one side, and then the South Americans on one side, and all the stuff on one side. Why is that? And even among the Arabs, you have cliques also. The Shamis on one side, the Egyptian one side, all these different actually traditions of Allah. But when you watch the youth, guess what? It's an amazing sight. They're all together, no boundaries. Why is that? Because they grow up not seeing these colors. They're color blind, basically. Put it this way. They don't see these colors, alhamdulillah, that's why it's kind of easy for them to connect with anyone from a different race. When you say from a different race, it's according to the parents, not necessarily to the children. On the other hand, parents are so worried about their kids making irrational choices as well as immature decisions. Why? Because, and I agree with parents, the level and the age of maturity was pushed higher than usual. Now, if you read the books of psychology, they usually give the stage of development to the children until they reach 12 years old. After 12 years old, suddenly it's open space. But before that, they organize the age, the group of basic human development, up to 12 years old. Why was that? Check these books, most of them are actually written at the beginning of the previous past century. And the reason for that, because that's how children were. Even here in New York, most of these studies were actually in this area over here. They would see children when they become 12 years old already running businesses. They're already running farms, they even drive tractors in the farm and all this stuff, so they're already mature. That's why they put in 12 years old. In our time right now, most parents, if Allah bless them with wealth, they keep pushing their kids for education, higher education, higher education, and don't worry about anything else. We'll take care of everything for you. So you find a child who's studying to become a doctor, he's always driving, mashallah, BMW. So why is he studying a doctor for? Just trying to figure out, why is he studying a doctor for? He's already have that luxury of life that provides him, you know, if he becomes a doctor. We're not preparing our children properly, so our children become immature, and when they are 20, 25 years old, still actually, they need some guidance, and that's what worries parents so much. So for the young ones, please understand where your parents are coming from. They want to see maturity. If they don't see it from you, they're going to resist your choices. And for the parents also, please see where your children are coming from. If you're going to have them marry someone that you like, they might please you, but then you might just cause them so much stress in that relationship that you yourself can actually reap afterwards. So as a recommendation, I would like to recommend to, again, it's all about line of communication. Parents to open up, inshallah, to their children, and children to open up when it comes to choices about marriage. Allah.
So I know it's time to close now, but we'll take the last question. There's a question about marrying a non-Muslim girl.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it is right or it should not be allowed to happen when there are so many other Muslim sisters available.
Then make it easy for them to get married, the girl, the Muslim girl.
Takbir.
Just make it simple and easy. We make it the halal so difficult that it's easier to marry a non-Muslim because it's only about $25 in the court, in the city hall, and we're done. You want to make it a little bit more expensive? Go to Las Vegas. And they marry this like there in any hall, but then they come back again. We're making it so difficult that our kids start going to these routes because it's easier. They don't require all these fancy shadi halls and wedding halls and the invitations and the color of the invitation and all the stuff. Just make it so simple. SubhanAllah, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, أَكْتَرُهُنَّ بَرَكَ أَقَلُّهُنَّ مَهَرَ. The less the mahar, the more the barakah and blessings in the relationship. I witnessed marriages. Wallah, I was there. Witnessed marriages where the mahar, the entire dowry was only surat wa duha wa layli idha sajad. It's not just something you read in books of history and tafsir. I witnessed that. I've seen marriage was the marriage that the whole dowry was a prayer rug, sujada. And I'm talking about young men and women of respected families. And there were no hidden strings. You know, that was actually just in front of everybody. But there was actually another fine font over there that says $100,000. Nothing hidden. No agendas. Parents, they like the family. They like the children. MashaAllah, they would like to help them get married. And Bismillah. Why do I have to have my child get married, start his marital relationship with a $20,000, $50,000 debt? I could have given this to him and put him in his pocket to start, mashallah, fresh instead of paying $100,000 in something that was going to end in a couple of hours. It's completely irrational, subhanAllah. I know most girls would like to have this Cinderella style wedding parties. There's nothing wrong with that, it's halal. But you are going to suffer the consequence of that fancy thing. It is so stressful. So stressful. Keep it simple, inshallah, it will be okay. As for marrying a non-Muslim, Islamically, it's halal to marry a Jewish woman or a Christian woman in general. But that's in terms of legal ruling. But in terms of decision making, Allahu A'lam, I would recommend that. The other thing is that for every guy who marries a non-Muslim girl, guess what? There's one extra Muslim girl who's going to end up with no husband.
Or non-Muslim.
Because the guy has the luxury of marrying a non-Muslim girl, right? And the girl, she won't have that luxury. And unfortunately, we're forcing them into making wrong choices as well. So remember that. It's a whole cycle, and it's going to affect each and every one of us who live in this community, not just me or that family. And many people that live in Saudi Arabia saying it's not me, it's the other family. And sooner or later, you will be actually part of that whole fabric of that society and community. Wallahu a'lam.
Inshallah, I'd like to ask Sahib to say a few concluding remarks.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I think we have all benefited. I do really admire your energy level. Very, very good energy level. Actually, Shaykh, he taught all day today. And he will be teaching tomorrow, inshallah, all day again. And that's a very good energy level. I pray Allah preserve your strength and keep you for us that we can benefit from you. Those who follow Shaykh on Facebook, he's a public figure. I was kind of trying to figure out, because we have a hadith for you. And I was not sure really what to have for you. So those who are following him as a public figure on Facebook, what he loves most? What he loves most?
Chocolate.
MashaAllah. So we have for him and his family, because I know he loved gifts for his family. We have here, Sheikh, can I borrow one of your phrases? Ya Jamal. Barakawfi. This is on behalf of our community. We really do appreciate you coming to us. And I think when you have been asked, you did not hesitate in coming. I pray Allah bless you and your family. So brothers and sisters, I hope that you have benefited. There are a lot of information here. We have it on tape. We inshallah will try to check the possibility. We could have copies of this for distribution inshallah in the future.
It's free online.
Pardon me?
It'll be online later.
It also will be on our website later inshallah. And for all the advices and the timely reminder, I pray that we all can start taking it very seriously, inshallah, and try to put it in our lives that we can be better for, inshallah. Barakallahu feek, wassalamu alaikum.